Can you guys hear me okay?
Yes.
I can hear you.
Great, thank you.
How are you, Seth?
How good are you?
hanging in there.
That's good.
Yeah.
I'm trying to be in a dog-free space in the house, so.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you're not, I'm used to seeing you in your kitchen.
Yeah, I'm often in the kitchen, or the weather's nice now, I'm outside a lot, but I thought today I should probably try to look a shade more professional, so. I don't really have an office. We have a mother-in-law's apartment across the carport in our house with no mother-in-law in it. But that's where Corey works on the 2 days she works from home. And so I'm probably going to turn our son's room into an office so that I have a space that's, you know, if I need a background or a place that looks quasi-professional, I'll have that.
Yawn a little bit.
A very good morning to everyone. Thank you for joining us today for the second DireFuse webinar. This is the second in the series of the webinars that we are going to run every month. Today we have the webinar from Nature Conservancy. But before we introduce you to the team from Nature Conservancy, I would like to give a few updates on the DireFuse workshops and the activities that we are doing. As I mentioned, I'm very eager to welcome all of you to the second webinar on behalf of my team. You can see our team partners down here. We have Texas A&M Energy Institute, Texas A&M University Kingsville, Mississippi State University, Rapid Manufacturing USA Institute, the Nature Conservancy, Southern University, Argonne National Lab, and Observer Research Foundation as our core partners. We are building our team and we are growing by the day. So if you are interested more to know about us, know more about this program and the initiative, please contact us. This is the second in our webinar. We have archived for those of you who joined us last month for our introduction webinar on disasters and their management. It has been archived on our website. You can see the website here. It's tx.ag/DireFuse webinars. You have the QR code to scan and you can view the archives. Today's webinar is also going to be archived. Give us a couple of days to upload it over the weekend. And you'll have today's webinar up there as well. Our upcoming webinar next month in April is Energy Systems Modeling from the Argonne National Lab. So if you have not yet registered for that, please register for at our website. Our workshops, we have started registering for our Mississippi workshop. So if you're interested and if you're in the Mississippi region, of course, DireFuse is spanning over Texas, Louisiana, Mississippi, as well as international location of Sundarbans in India. But we are having in-person workshops. It will be great to see people meet in person. So Mississippi workshop is on 23rd of May and the registration is open. We are very soon going to open the registration for the Louisiana and the Texas workshops as well. So please, please, please register as soon as you can because the seats are limited. So if you are in the region, please do register. The format of the workshops, just to give you a glimpse of what we are planning to offer to you as well as to learn from you. We will be having an opening plenary panel on anatomy of disasters, after which we will be introducing the DireFuse Consortium. And the plans for consortium development for this program. The opening plenary is an invited panel. We are getting very high level speakers from the industry, academia, as well as our extension services and the government at the top levels of government. So, please check out those in our website. We will be having a core breakout session on convergence research and followed by two parallel breakout sessions on diversity, equity, culture of inclusion, and education and workforce development. And as a service to the attendees, we will be offering two tutorial sessions, one from Rapid Manufacturing USA Institute on modular process intensification. And the second one will be on water energy food nexus methods to facilitate systems analysis. So these will be, again, the tutorial sessions are concurrent sessions. You can join either of those sessions and get value out of your attendance at the workshops. Visit us at our website. Subscribe to let us know of your interests, where you would like to participate in the events of the DireFuse. And with that, I would like to turn it over to Seth. Seth is facilitating our our webinar today from the Nature Conservancy. Over to you, Seth.
All right, Devlina, thank you very much. Welcome everyone. Thanks for making the time to participate this morning. My name is Seth Blitch, and I am the Coastal Program Director for the Nature Conservancy in Louisiana. The title of today's webinar is Resilience Along Coastal and Wetland Corridors, and we have assembled a really bright and active group of TNC and partner staff to describe some of the work that we're doing in the Gulf region, the states in the Gulf region. So I'm going to share my screen. And I'm going to... Okay. I'm hoping everyone can see this now. All right, good. Lauren's nodding her head. Okay, good. All right. So as mentioned, this is the title of the workshop. We will have sort of four sections to this workshop. I will introduce the speakers as we get to each section. We are going to hold all questions for each of the panelists until the very end, until all the panelists have spoken. But as we proceed through this, if you don't want to forget your question, you can put your questions in the Q&A box at the bottom of the screen. And at the end, we will go through those and then have the panelists address those. I opened with this picture because it touches on about everything you're going to hear about today. We're going to talk a lot about water. Water is necessary for all life, including human life, and it also poses a threat frequently because of how we find ourselves in space and in time. This is a picture of the Mississippi River, which is a hub of commerce. There's an ocean-going vessel there. The river itself is levied, which protects all kinds of industry and residential areas that you can see. And then towards the back of the image, you can actually see some of the coastal marshes that are slowly converting to open water because we have a high rate of land loss in Louisiana in particular. And so you're going to hear from each of the panelists about ways to address these changes, to become more resilient around both freshwater and coastal systems, and to really work with the natural resources that you have at your disposal through either honoring what's there or restoring and protecting places. So with that, I will turn it over first to Lauren Williams. Lauren is in Texas. She is the Resilient Coast Director there. And Lauren is going to talk to us a little bit about CRS. So Lauren, with that, I will give it to you.
Thanks, Seth. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us. Today, like Seth said, I'm going to be talking about TNC's CRS Explorer tool. And CRS stands for Community Rating System, which is a program of FEMA's. Oh, Seth, there we go. Next slide. Okay, so CRS, like I was saying, is FEMA's community rating system. It's a voluntary program that provides discounts on flood insurance premiums for communities that exceed minimum requirements of the National Flood Insurance Program. Next. And so if you're not familiar with CRS, there are different classes of CRS, and you get points for different activities that you do to enhance the community's flood resilience. And those points relate to discounts on the community's flood insurance premiums. So as you move up a class and your community becomes more flood resilient, you get higher discounts on your flood insurance rates through the National Flood Insurance Program. Next slide. So here in Texas, there are about 70 CRS eligible communities. And the average class in Texas is a 7, which means the communities are receiving a 15% discount on their flood insurance premiums. Next. Oh. It's not working. That's okay. What would a webinar be without technical issues?
Sorry, everyone. It's not advancing right now. Golly, hold on. I'm gonna stop sharing and reshare again and see if that helps.
Okay. There we go. Okay. Like I was saying, the community can engage in different activities to enhance their flood mitigation that's happening. And these activities fall under four categories for CRS. So public information, mapping and regulations, flood damage reduction, and flood preparedness, warning and response. And these activities are summarized in this document that's highlighted here. It's an official's guide to community rating system, which is a really quick read. And then it's kind of in a lot of detail described in the coordinator's manual, which is hundreds of pages. Next slide. So here are the categories of the CRS activities that I just described, and then what falls into those categories. And then the points that the community can get for engaging in those activities. And in order for a community to move up a class, remember it takes 500 points. So a community might want to focus on those activities that would get them the most points, but also relates to methods in which they can reduce flood impacts to their community. And so those activities that can get the community a lot of points and really help them to mitigate flood impacts are open space preservation, higher regulatory standards, acquisition and relocation. So, getting people out of harm's way who have already developed in the floodplain and are experiencing flood impacts. So those are just examples of activities that really can get a community a lot of points. Next slide. And so why is the Nature Conservancy working on CRS? Well, our mission is to conserve the lands and waters on which all life depends. And this kind of overlaps with FEMA's CRS program in a number of ways, but specifically in preservation of open space in the floodplain. Next slide. So open space protection gets communities points through CRS, and they can be earned by protecting any part of the floodplain, which is defined as free from buildings, filling, pavement, or other encroachment to flood flows. And then bonus points can be received for communities that, like I mentioned earlier, have already developed in a floodplain, but that remove that development and then restore that area back to pre-development conditions. Next slide. Go back one more. I did want to highlight that a recent study estimated that savings associated with 1 point increase in CRS activity for open space preservation on average can save a community over $3,500 a year. Okay, so TNC developed a CRS Explorer tool, which basically helps planners visualize where current land is protected that is earning their community CRS points, and where land could be protected in the future and add points that they're receiving through CRS program. And so ultimately, the tool can help planners and others to improve the community CRS score, but also to make communities more resilient to flooding, and can also support community planning decisions. So if there are areas that have been identified for future open space preservation, a community could choose to target that area and then maybe, utilize it for co-benefits. So for example, developing some sort of community park or something like that, that's not only serving flood mitigation, but could also be providing recreational benefits or something like that. Next slide. So how do you calculate CRS open space points? Well, thankfully NOAA has developed a really great GIS workflow that makes it really easy for a community. Well, not easy, but sets out the steps to do it. And so just to summarize it, basically you calculate the areas of the community's special flood hazard area. And then you identify undeveloped parcels that are in that special flood hazard area. And then you look and see if those parcels have already been protected from development, either through conservation easements or some sort of land use restrictions. Next slide. So this is TNC, a screenshot of TNC's CRS Explorer tool. We've engaged with communities in the states that are highlighted in green. So you can see, three of the Gulf states and then up the East Coast. The next slide. In Texas, we've worked with Rockport and Aransas County. So for those of you not familiar with Texas, that's where that green star is right there, or blue star. Next slide. So in Aransas, this is a screenshot of the tool for Aransas County. It's kind of hard to see. So I zoomed in a little bit. Next. And so what you can see noted in light green is that those are areas that are already protected that could be generating CRS points for the community. And then in dark green, you can see areas that are not currently protected but could generate additional CRS points for the community if they were protected. Next. So that area right there would be the focus for protection if that community wanted to generate more CRS points. And next. So basically, so Aransas County is not currently a part of the CRS program, but they're putting together documentation to become a part of the CRS program. And so by working with us, they were able to map out points that they should be currently receiving for open space protection, which is only 16 points in this case for this community. But they are also able to identify, where they could generate an additional 65 credits for this community. And so this really helped them to put together their package that they have to submit to FEMA to become a part of the CRS. Next slide.
Hold on, it froze again. I'll do the same thing.
Okay.
Very sorry.
No worries. It's a big slide deck. Okay, so Rockport, Texas, which is in Aransas County, is currently a part of the CRS program. If we zoom in a little bit, you can see up in the kind of northwestern corner of the community, there's a lot of opportunity for protection of open space. Next, I think I highlighted it. And so the benefit of working with this community on CRS is that according to a review they had done in 2017, they only received 62 points for open space credit. But by working with us to map out, to map this out using the NOAA GIS workflow, we were able to determine that they should be receiving 82 points for CRS credit. And so, so that does help improve their score a little bit, but we were also able to help them identify opportunities for additional credit through CRS. And so for both of these communities, if you recall that you need 500 points to move up a class in CRS, they might benefit more by, implementing regulations, for example, that would generate protection in the floodplain. But I wanted to highlight another community, which is not in Texas, but that we worked with. So next slide. And this is Jefferson County, Florida. Next slide. So in this community, you can see that so that light green again is the current or proposed points that are owed to the community through CRS. So if you zoom in again, there's also a lot of opportunity for additional protection to generate more points here in this region. Next. But the community actually did not have the capacity to do this mapping to assess how many points they should be earning through CRS for open space protection. And so by working with us, what we were able to determine is that, you know, they actually should be receiving over 1,000 points, 1,130 points through through CRS for open space protection, which would raise the county by 2 CRS classes and earn their county residents an additional 10% off their flood insurance premiums. So that's a huge savings. Thank you, Seth. And something that we were really excited to be able to support this community with. Next. And so just to kind of summarize, you know, we've used the tool to help communities verify their open space protection points that they should be receiving, and in some cases, potentially move up a CRS class or two. And it can also help communities identify areas of future open space protection that they can use for planning. You know, we learned that mapping open space protection, it can be time consuming and it's technically challenging. And so, you know, using our resources and NOAA's resources to help these communities has helped in situations where they didn't have the capacity. And so, you know, if you or your community would be interested in getting your data into this tool, we would be happy to hear from you. And please reach out to me if you're interested. Thank you so much.
All right, Lauren, thanks very much. You get a gold star. You finished within time. So that's really good. So next, I think I figured out what makes my screen freeze. If I check anything in the chat or Q&A, the next action I do doesn't work. So I just won't do that until the end. So Ryan Smith is up next. He, as you can read, is our Director of Water and Science for the Nature Conservancy in Texas and is going to talk to you about his work in the Sustainable Rivers Program. So Ryan, take it away.
Great. Thank you, Seth. Okay. So thanks for the invite to join in this. And what I'm going to talk to you about today is a program that we have in the Conservancy. It's a partnership program called the Sustainable Rivers Program. And really talk to you about how this is an example of the reoperation of a certain type of gray infrastructure for environmental benefit, including resiliency. So to set the stage a little bit for this, first we're in a full-blown global water scarcity crisis with in different evaluations, up to two-thirds of the world's population expected to be water stressed by 2025, many cases already, including, if you look at that map, some of the area of interest in today, particularly in Texas, and we're going into another drought period now. Okay, next slide. And we're also facing energy, drastically increasing energy needs. And hydropower is expected to expand globally, potentially by as much as 50% in order to help meet that, meet our energy needs. And the challenge we have is to think about how to address these water scarcity needs, develop water supply, think about how we're gonna maintain our food supply in the face of that scarcity crisis. And also in developing our energy through more gray infrastructure like this, and how to do that in a way that meets the human needs, but also maintains the ecosystems and their conservation benefit, but also the importance to resiliency. Okay, next slide. And one of the things that development of water infrastructure leads to is one of the biggest impacts to freshwater biodiversity into ecosystems and also the services that ecosystems provide. And that's in the form of hydrologic alteration. So what the Conservancy has been working on with partners for a long time is how can we make this development of infrastructure and also operation of current infrastructure, how can we make this a little bit more sustainable for the environmental side, but also, you know, as we're facing, you know, increasingly facing the manifestation of, changing climatic patterns and need to be thinking about resiliency. You know, how can we enhance these downstream ecosystems, floodplains for from the standpoint of resiliency. Okay, next slide. So one thing that the Conservancy has done since the late 90s is we've been working closely with the Army Corps of Engineers, the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, which is by far the largest operator of water infrastructure in the United States and in the world. And we've been exploring for them, or with them, ways in which we can operate that infrastructure a little bit differently and maintain the critical purposes that infrastructure needs, but also enhance downstream benefit. And this program is now called the Sustainable Rivers Program. Okay, next slide. So here's the mission and the goal of this program. And basically it's can we find ways to, like I said, to continue to meet those critical, you know, flood risk reduction, water supply, hydropower, recreation, you know, all the critical purposes that this infrastructure supplies. Can we do that in a way that's more environmentally sustainable? Okay, next. So like I mentioned, this partnership started in the early 90s, in the late 90s, in Kentucky with our Kentucky chapter of the Nature Conservancy, working with the Corps on a couple of dams in the Green River system, where they were really trying to explore ways that they could deal with this this challenge of federally listed freshwater mussels and endangered species management downstream of some of these dams, and started trying to experiment with learning what the science is related to the flow needs downstream of the reservoir, and if there are ways that they could operate that reservoir within the operational envelope of the reservoir to have environmental benefit. And there was, and that led to, in the early 2000s, some real enthusiasm on the part of certain areas of the Corps to explore this a little bit more. So in 2002, we signed an MOU with the Corps, and 2004, 2005, started by identifying 8 places around the US where we could explore this a little bit more, and really in the way of demonstration. And that is, can we take what we've seen from the Green River and also from other places where other dam operators around the world have were experimenting with this? Can we expand this to other core projects and really demonstrate the efficacy? And the good news is here we are 20 years later, and the answer is definitely yes. I'm just jumping way ahead on this timeline. We now have over 40 rivers with 89 reservoirs and more than, it's actually even more than this now, but more than 11,000 downstream river miles in the program. And several of these rivers have gotten to the stage of where they've successfully demonstrated the environmental benefits. Okay, next. So I'm gonna talk a little bit about the process and the approach that we've taken at these sites to give you some idea of how the program works. Okay, next slide. So we talk about this in this process now in kind of 3 stages. And the first is advance. And this is where we advance our understanding of the ecosystems downstream of the reservoirs, and also our understanding of the operational constraints and needs for the reservoir. And where we learn about downstream, what are the ways that the ecosystem, the floodplain, that the human benefits from those ecosystems, how they relate to flow. And also what's feasible, what more could we actually do with this reservoir based on the current operational regimen. Next slide. And then using some tools, many of which were developed by the Nature Conservancy and by the Corps of Engineers, using some tools to then in a workshop setting, actually design a flow regime or design a set of flow releases that could put back some of that that function that's been lost, or could enhance the health of the downstream ecosystems. And thinking all through there, what are some of the particular functions, whether it's fish spawning or whatever, or inundating floodplain forests to enhance floodplain health? What are these targeted things that we want to do with these flows, and what do we think it would take to do that? Okay, next. And then in the implement phase is where oftentimes initially is an experimental basis. Let's go ahead and release some of these flows and set up the monitoring to see if they, first of all, the flows do what we hypothesized for trying to release flows to get up into the floodplain and enhance floodplain, you know, recruitment or anything. Does it actually get there? Do we start seeing ecological response and have that monitoring in place so we can see if it's doing what we hypothesized? And next slide. And then if that process goes well, we're able to implement flows on an experimental basis and see that they're responding well and that the stakeholders buy into it, and we haven't seen any impacts to either operation of water supply systems or flood risk reduction, anything like that, then what the ultimate goal is incorporate. And that is to incorporate the flow recommendations into the operational regimen of that reservoir. Many times this takes the form of incorporating the flows into the water control plan or water control manual for the reservoirs, but could take other forms also. And we've gotten to this stage with a number of places around the US, but one point is just, once we've gotten here, we've gotten to our goal, but we also continue in the adaptive management framework to see if we're, number one, if we continue to get these longer term responses, particularly longer term ecological processes like floodplain health enhancement, things like that. But also if our objectives change, then we can modify these things as we go along. Okay, next slide. So just to give you one example of where this is taking place in this area, and that's Big Cypress Bayou and Caddo Lake in Northeast Texas, Northwest Louisiana, which was one of those 8 original sites. Okay, next slide. In this case, what we're trying to do is over on the right side, you can see Caddo Lake there on the border. And then if you go to the left upstream, there's Lake of the Pines. What we're trying to do here is change operations of Lake of the Pines, Barrels Bridge Dam, to enhance the Big Cypress Bayou downstream of it. That's the stream that goes through Jefferson and Uncertain there and into the lake. And through operating Lake of the Pines, benefit the downstream bayou and the lake. And one thing I also want to highlight while we're here is that there's still a good portion of this watershed that's not regulated. And there's actually, increasing issues with flooding as a result of that unregulated watershed. So one of the things that's definitely part of this work also is, can we use operations of Lake of the Pines to mitigate some of that downstream flood issue, particularly by enhancing the floodplain down into above Caddo Lake and into the top of it. Okay, next. So long story short, on the left here is what the flow recommendations ended up being. And this was developed in the early 2000s. And we've been implementing these flows experimentally since the early 2010s. And in 2018, adopted the flow recommendations into the water control manual for Farrell's Bridge Dam on Lake of the Pines. So we've worked all the way through these stages of all the way to incorporate. Okay, next slide. So one of the things I mentioned, in the implement phase is putting in the monitoring to see if we're actually doing what we're hoping to do. And just to give you a quick snapshot of that in this one, one of the targets here was our fish community because it's a great kind of canary in the coal mine, if you will, because it responds relatively quickly to flow and is an indicator of ecosystem health. And the take-home message of this is that the top graph is some of the fish we want to see there more of. The one on the bottom is some of the ones that had increased during the flow alteration. And that last set of dots on the far right shows what's happened after the flow implementation. So there was a general decreasing trend of what we wanted to see, then a response pretty quickly, which has actually continued. This was just the first year of data. So the fish community has responded very well already. Next slide. The other big target here is the kind of the iconic bald cypress swamp in floodplain forests in both bayou and the upper parts of the lake. And this is where we're currently focusing, is trying to think outside the box on how we could implement more of those higher end of our flow prescription, if you will, to enhance the floodplain forest, which, like I mentioned, is one of the things that we're thinking about more here now is, you know, again, can we think about this not just from the forest health benefit, but, you know, increasingly, can we get some more benefit by enhancing health or maybe even expanding the footprint of the floodplain forest a bit to help mitigate against flood damage that's coming largely from the unregulated parts of the watershed. So that's where we're going now, and hopefully make some more ground on the high flow end. So here's the map, the map of where the program stands now. Actually, there's more even to this. And the one thing I wanted to highlight here too is as funding has increased and we've demonstrated success in the eFlows, we've expanded this program to some different kinds of infrastructure, including locks and dams, seeing if those can be operated in a way that can enhance both fish migrations, but also habitat within the pools of, you know, between the different locks and dams, and also other kinds of poor infrastructure like dry dams, which are not operated for flows, but could have some other kinds of resiliency benefits. Okay, that's it. Next slide. Here's my information if you want to learn more about this program, and look forward to taking any questions at the end. So, thanks, Seth.
All right, Ryan, thanks very much. And I will have everyone's contact and email information at the very last slide of the end too. If you missed it during the presentation, you will have a chance to copy it. So if you want to get in touch with any of these panelists, you will be able to do that. Okay, next we have Chris Shepherd. Chris is the science director for the Nature Conservancy's Gulf of Mexico program, and is, I think, just lives the resilience life and does this every day. Chris, I will turn over to you to talk about your scaling up nature-based solutions effort.
Thank you, Seth. And thank you for the opportunity to present to your team today. I'm going to be talking about SUNS, that stands for Scaling Up Nature-Based Solutions. This is a project that we developed in the Florida Panhandle to develop a portfolio of nature-based solutions, with the idea being that to really augment the resilience of coastal communities and watersheds, we need to have a more regional watershed-based approach rather than individual one-off nature-based solutions projects. And that there are a lot of underserved local governments that don't really have the resources to do the planning to achieve those goals. Slide, please. So as I mentioned, this project in its current iteration in Florida takes place in a 3-county region that was impacted by Hurricane Michael in 2018. Slide. Hurricane Michael was a Category 5 hurricane when it made landfall and was extremely destructive. And as a result of the impacts to the region from Hurricane Michael, our team decided to partner with Northeastern University and the U.S. Naval Academy to try and evaluate if there was any relationship between the damage impacts from Hurricane Michael and the natural infrastructure or the nature or the habitats in that region. Slide, please. So the very first phase of SUNS, which takes place in these three counties that you can see here in the Panhandle of Florida, was a science study, essentially trying to understand what we could tease out using a variety of approaches ranging from field work, homeowner mailed surveys, remote imagery analysis, and some GIS spatial analysis slide. And so what we found as, this is a summary of our project team. Our another partner is the Water Management District in Northwest Florida. And we also have a planner on our team, which has been a tremendous asset. So Anna Jane Jones is a NOAA Digital Coast Fellow that the Nature Conservancy is hosting for 2 years. And she has a master's degree in urban and regional planning and really brings in the skills, an additional skill set that's really critical for these types of projects. Next slide. And so based on our findings in the science project, and then just our experience working on nature-based solutions for over 15 years now, we really feel that a concerted regional effort is really what makes sense at this point in time. And so we learned a lot, taking more of a one-off approach to developing and implementing nature-based solutions projects, but we're trying to learn how to scale that up in both a planning context and an implementation context. And we really feel like there are efficiencies in both time and money if you can plan and implement suites of projects together. Slide. I think there's a slide. Okay, so this slide kind of shows, this is from the cover of some of our reports that we released about this work, which was looking at measuring and mapping the impacts of the hurricane to understand the role that nature played. If anyone is interested in those, the summaries from that work, we've also had a few manuscripts pending and accepted right now. I will put the project website in the chat at the end of my talk, and you'll be able to access that information if you're interested in exploring that further. Slide. So as a result of our findings in the science study, which really was that folks in the panhandle that had more natural shorelines compared to hardened shorelines, they really didn't fare any different as far as their self-reported damage level and their recovery of their shorelines after the hurricane. We couldn't really find a statistical difference between the outcomes if you had a natural shoreline with the more natural vegetation of that region versus a hardened shoreline like a seawall or a bulkhead. And we also found that folks that had those hardened shorelines had to spend a lot more money to repair them after the hurricane. We also found that individual homeowners that were living in an area closer to more green space had a quicker and faster recovery as far as the recovery of their household and their mental self-reported mental recovery, even when we accounted for socioeconomic factors, distance to the storm, things like that. So based off the findings from the science study and also based off of the ever-increasing amounts of money in the United States and in Florida specifically for planning, designing, and implementing nature-based solutions, we decided to apply for funding to engage in a regional planning process to do exactly what Seth mentioned in the introduction, which is honor the existing nature, so ensure that it's protected, and then identify where there's our opportunities to manage or restore or create additional nature-based solutions to increase the resilience of this portion of the coastline in the future. Slide. So that takes us to the SUNS project. This was funded by a National Coastal Resilience Fund grant, which those are administered through the National Fish and Wildlife Foundation. And so the project goals for SUNS are to provide local governments with decision-making knowledge and tools about how to plan and use nature-based solutions, to develop and facilitate a regional stakeholder-based planning process that will ultimately end up with a portfolio of projects. So we're shooting for about 40 to 50 nature-based solutions projects at the end of the planning process. And then the final phase of that work is to encourage adoption and implementation of the portfolio by providing technical assistance and capacity building support. A lot of the communities in this area are what we refer to as underserved. meaning that they haven't had a lot of success so far in accessing some of these nature-based solutions funding pots. A lot of the bigger pots of money for nature-based solutions have been flowing towards larger, more urban developed areas in Florida, when you think of like a Miami-Dade or a Tampa. And so that cycle continues as those larger, more high capacity local governments access more of the funding, they're able to add more staff and continue to access that money. So we are developed the SUNS process to be able to try to provide the planning technical support and the implementation technical support to help address this gap that we have observed across the Gulf of Mexico and the southeastern US. Slide, please. So the timeline for the SUNS project is last spring, we started gathering information, having a lot of one-on-one individual interviews with stakeholders and local governments in the region to understand where they sit with respect to their knowledge and implementation of nature-based solutions. And then starting last summer, we stood up a working group, and the working group is the core of how we are developing the portfolio of nature-based solutions. We are almost at the end of the process of identifying all the potential projects, and then there'll be a series of community dialogues to help select the final portfolio. And then the remaining year and a half of the project is really devoted to advancing those projects. Slide, please. You can keep going. So the SUNS portfolio in a nutshell is a suite of nature-based solutions projects that aligns with regional strategies. So they are linked across the region. They're suitable for state and federal funding, and they both reduce risk and benefit fish and wildlife. Those are the two kind of requirements of NFWF, National Fish and Wildlife Foundation, Coastal Resilience Fund projects, but those are also the goals that many of the projects that we're sharing with you today also have that in common. Slide. The final product for SUNS portfolio will be a document and a map that lists out the project types, locations, the benefits, the likely project benefits associated with them, how they sit with respect to regional significance, and also potential funding sources for implementation. Slide. So the SUNS portfolio can be used to scale up funding and construct nature-based solutions in the region. We are not looking to lead the implementation of these projects, but we are looking to provide support to the members of the working group to apply for funding and implement these projects with our support. Next slide. So how do we develop the SUNS portfolio? Slide. We have the working group, as I mentioned. So there are 12 cities, 3 counties, and then a dozen other entities ranging from state, federal agencies, and academic partners. Slide. And what we do is we meet monthly, and through most of this has taken place virtually due to COVID, which has been a challenge, but we've been, I think, pretty successful in achieving our goals and having a team kind of cohesive spirit associated with the SUNS project. But this process here, and Seth, you can tab twice just to kind of move to the end of this one, really is about bringing together all of the spatial information so that it can be explored in an easy to understand way. So what we've done is bring in information from the working group's preference of what hazards they're concerned about, what nature-based solutions they're interested in. And also we've pulled together existing information about priority fish and wildlife habitat that exists at the southeastern US scale, at the Florida scale. And then we've kind of integrated that information together to map out where we think there's opportunity for different types of nature-based solutions. We've also brought in their existing plans and efforts so that we're acknowledging those and building off of those. And then the regional strategies that you can see here kind of are like funnels in which we view the planning process. And we have an iterative planning process where we focus on identifying projects through each of those regional strategies. And we have our last meeting on regional recreation economy coming up in 2 weeks. Next slide. I'm gonna skip this one, go ahead. So as I mentioned, we have these 4 workshops where we're identifying project ideas and putting them on our mapping tool. The first one was green space in the floodplain, which is very aligned to everything that folks have shared earlier. The second one is community stormwater management. So thinking about, rather than individual stormwater management at the parcel scale, are there larger regional stormwater parks that we could develop that have recreational amenities and could potentially increase ecotourism? The third workshop, shoreline protection, really focuses on nature-based shoreline protection involving living shorelines and oyster reefs. And then the last workshop we have, which is coming up, is the regional recreation economy. It's really thinking about how to link these projects together in a way that can support the economic development of these communities. Next slide. So this is where we are in the process. We're finishing up the project portfolio draft ideas, and then we're gonna move into the community dialogues to get feedback from folks that would be impacted or benefit from those projects. And then in fall of 2022, finalize the portfolio projects. Slide. To support this effort, we developed the SUNS map app, which brings all of the spatial information in an easy to use decision support tool. So we have information in there on existing projects, priority locations that the working group members have identified. And then our science team brings to the conversation these opportunity maps. So for each of those nature-based solutions projects types that you can see there, we've mapped out where we think the opportunity is to implement those in areas that are likely to see reduced risk from the implementation of those projects and benefit fish and wildlife. And then through the map app, we explore those maps in our workshops, and then the working group participants add their project ideas to the maps. Slide. I think I have way too many slides. You can just kind of tab through a couple. I wasn't sure if you guys were going to share this deck, so I included some of these maps of the individual opportunity maps, so that folks can kind of take a look at that if they're interested in kind of seeing the kinds of spatial data that we've created. Can you kind of keep going like two more, Seth? Keep going. This just kind of summarizes those various nature-based solutions types that I mentioned on the slide. So I think three more tabs would be good. Do. All right, next one. So this map right here just kind of shows what these opportunity maps look like, and each color is a different type of nature-based solution. So what this allows our community members, our working group members to do, is to look at their individual community and see what is the opportunity to harness the nature that's already there, and what can we do to augment and restore it as kind of like our first line of defense. And where there is a lot of colors on the map in one spot, that's where you can see where there's a lot of opportunity to do a living shoreline and restore the wetlands and protect areas where the wetlands might migrate inland with sea level rise. Next slide. You can skip this one. So we are at the end of the process of developing the portfolio, which, as I mentioned, would be early fall 2022. We're moving into that technical assistance and project development phase. Next slide. So we have been fortunate enough to receive a grant from the Walmart Foundation to support additional technical support, proposal writing, and capacity to help support the working group members and their communities in taking these project ideas and moving them through feasibility studies and preliminary design. And then for a handful of them, we are looking to move them all the way through 100% design and construction. Next slide. So just to finish, and I wanted to leave this idea with you that the SUNS process can be used to scale up funding and construct nature-based solutions projects at the region across the Gulf of Mexico and beyond. It's something that's adaptable to local data, although much of the information that we've included could be used across the Gulf of Mexico. And the basic idea here is that we have the spatial information to know what's possible with respect to nature-based solutions. So now we're really focused on helping communities, corporations, local governments really understand what's possible and then plan to take advantage of that. Thanks, Seth.
All right, Chris, thanks very much. It was terrific. I can't believe you got it all in.
sort of.
Well done. Okay, finally, we have a team of co-presenters for this last section. Michelle Eddy, who is with the Research Triangle Institute, and they have been a great partner to the Nature Conservancy in the development of a lot of the tools that you have heard and will hear about today. And then Brian Piazza, who is the Director of Freshwater Marine Science for the Nature Conservancy in Louisiana. And with that, I will turn it over to you, Michelle and Brian.
Thanks, Seth. Today, Michelle and I are going to talk about the application of RTI's waterfall hydrologic model to help gain a better understanding about water quantity and water quality issues, and also for water management and watershed planning. So first, Michelle's going to talk about a project they worked on in North Carolina, and then I'll return to show some products that our team has developed in partnership with Michelle's team in our state of Louisiana. Go ahead, Seth.
All right, and you can hit one more time, Seth. So as Brian said, I'm demonstrating a modeling effort that we've done within North Carolina, but also leads into work that we've done in Louisiana and Mississippi. And this also ties into what Lauren, Ryan, and Chris have all talked about, where we are looking for areas to conserve natural lands within a watershed. But we're doing that through a modeling exercise that will let us take a look into the future and figure out what we expect to happen in terms of changes to the hydrology and the water quality throughout a watershed. And what we've defined here is we're looking what we called for hotspots, which is a drainage area where we're expecting to see greater amount of changes, but also an area where if there is natural land, that there is an opportunity to mitigate some of those changes through conservation. And the key part of this is also that we're able to do this spatially with a quantitative model, but we're also able to put the economic benefits, cost and benefits around conservation in each of these areas. Go ahead, Seth. So the way we do this is that we've developed a model at RTI called Waterfall, which is the Watershed Flow and Allocation System. And what this model does is it works on the Enhanced National Hydrography Dataset within the US, which is takes all the rivers and streams throughout the US and breaks them down into individual stream segments, and then also defines the small catchment drainage area around each one of those segments that feeds in water to that part of the stream. So using this data set as the underlying pin for our model, we're able to look at each individual section of stream and also accumulate the flows through a network and characterize an entire watershed. The example I'm showing here is the Catawba Watery Basin in North and South Carolina. And this is about a 4,800 square mile basin where when we use the NHD Plus data set as our hydrologic network, that gives us about 7,500 divisions of the streams and networks throughout that basin. And with our model waterfall, we then do a hydrologic model along each one of those pieces of the stream. So we end up with 7,500 simulations of daily hydrology for that whole watershed. And the watershed model, as you can see this cartoon in the middle, you know, it's a rainfall runoff model. So it's going to look at how rain hits the surface, what's on that surface, what's the land cover, what's the soil conditions, and based on that, it'll determine how much is going to run off, how much is going to sink into the ground, and eventually come into the river as base flow. We also have worked into this model human alterations, so where there's pipes in the streams, either sucking out water or putting water back in, and where there are reservoirs, and we have a basic mass balance reservoir operation to fill and spill from those reservoirs along the network system. So we're able to take a really high resolution look at what's happening in this watershed. And by having all of those inputs and the watershed built up from these small pieces, we can do different scenarios, which lets us take a look at what do we think might happen in the future throughout this watershed. And we often do that looking at land use change, climate change, and even the human alterations to the system with water use change. And then we also look at mitigation. So if you were able to conserve land within this basin, how much of those potential future changes could you mitigate? Go ahead, Seth. And one more time. And as I mentioned, you know, one of the key things here is land use change. So we can take a look at what our baseline land use is in the model and what we think one of these future projections will be. And that will change the inputs around what's happening on that land cover and that surface of the watershed. So when we do our model, we now have different hydrology and responses within the stream network from land use. So we can plan for what might happen as development continues and other sorts of land use changes. Next one, you can hit twice. And same thing around climate. You know, we can look at changes in precipitation or changes in temperature, as we're shown here on this chart, where we were looking at a 0.4 degrees centigrade increase in temperatures each decade as we modeled. And so having those changes to the inputs of the model also lets us take account for how the stream flows are going to change due to climate changes. Okay, next one. And so what we end up with is a daily simulation of the stream flows for each one of those 7,500 pieces of watershed. And that's a lot of information. So what do we do with that? Hit one more time, Seth. Is we distill that down to a set of hydrologic metrics. And from that, we're able to compare between the baseline and the future scenario and the mitigation scenario to say how much change are we expected in, for instance, if we're looking at floods, the number of peak flows, or the duration of these high flow events that are occurring, or even the threshold of what the 90th percentile of flow, what are those real peak flows? What stream flow does that equal to? And we're able to look at that and see how that's going to change into the future. And also, again, how the mitigation of those changes could be done by, in this case, conserving natural lands. Next slide. And what we end up with here is by using those different metrics and looking at and selecting different metrics from our examination, we can craft different vulnerability scenarios to assess. So on the left side here, we have base flow vulnerability. So we're looking at any change in minimum flows, the flashiness or flows, and the 7Q10 value. And the what pops up is this pink to red locations on the map. Those are the catchments where you're expecting a greater proportion of change in those metrics. And so where we expect base flows to be the most altered going into the future. And in the middle map, we have sediment loading vulnerability, where again, using more of the water quality side of things, plus also high flow metrics, we can highlight the areas where we're expecting a greater sediment loading into the system from these areas of the watershed. And then on the right, we have flooding vulnerability, where we're looking at the high flow metrics and the flashiness, and the pink areas that pop up are the areas we'd focus on conservation if we wanted to protect from flooding. Also within this basin, there's a large amount of conserved land already in the headwaters. You can see there's a Pisgah National Forest. So there's a lot of conserved areas, and we took into account areas where there, how much conservation was already there versus how much could be done and how much natural land within each one of these catchments there is to protect. Go ahead, Seth. So once we have those changes that are expected, what we can do with that is look at the potential change in both natural area cover and the sediment load resulting from those changes in the hydrology and land use cover or climate change. And so we were able to use benefit transfer functions. So when we looked at avoided sediment loads to the reservoirs, this watershed actually has 11 reservoirs in series, we can take the benefit that we would expect recreational visitors to have from higher water quality. So when there's more sediment, your water gets less transparent, people don't like that as much, recreation slows. So we looked at three different economic measures there, recreation benefits, the benefit to lakeshore property values, and then the drinking water treatment for the utilities that have intakes along these reservoirs. And then we also have the benefits from just maintaining tree cover within a catchment. And we were looking at both the carbon sequestration benefits of that and then the improved human health benefits by having trees and air filtration from those trees. So that allows us to have an economic value per acre of conserved land or per ton of sediment mitigated. Sediment loading mitigated for each of these catchments. And then we can also look at the cost. If you were to, in this case, we looked at the full tax assessed value of the parcels within these catchments. So if you were to purchase this catchment, this parcel within that catchment, how many acres of land can you conserve with that? And then what is the cost of purchasing that parcel? So we're able to get a full cost benefit analysis of conserving lands in each of these areas of the watershed that are targeted. Next. And this is a map when you combine both the hotspots and the economic benefits for conservation. And so the darkest catchments in black, you actually get a net benefit over the cost of conserving the land in these areas. And then as it goes down into lighter gray, you have less benefit. And the thing I forgot to mention here is that you can see the North South Carolina border is right there. If you follow that line straight across to the east side of the watershed, that's the city of Charlotte. And so you can see right in the center of Charlotte, there's not so much land to conserve. And also the benefits around that area are a little bit lower because it's so expensive to purchase the land and conserve land in that area. Whereas up in the headwaters of the basin, land's less expensive. So you have a higher cost benefit to conserving land in those areas. And then also improving your water quality and hydrology from the headwaters down through the whole river. Okay, next slide. And so we've taken this work, we did this work with the Catawba Waterway Water Management Group, who operates, that's the drinking water utilities and Duke Energy who operate within that basin, and then also the conservation organizations that are active in that basin. And so with that, we've been able to put an online tool together. The link there is on the bottom left. And you can go to the next slide, Seth. And this online tool has maps that users can click through so they can narrow in. If they have a specific parcel that they're targeting, they can go into this map and look and find where it falls in these catchments and get the benefits. And if they have a big pool of money and say, where's the best place for me to look, they can use these maps and also drill down to and set some priorities based on those maps. And I believe that's it for me. And we're going to turn it over to Brian to talk about how we've used this type of modeling in Louisiana.
Thanks, Michelle. In 2012, we entered a partnership with RTI to apply waterfall to Louisiana and Mississippi. We modeled about 58,000 individual catchments in Louisiana and about 55,000 catchments in Mississippi. I'm going to show Louisiana today. So for each individual catchment, we can produce a hydrograph representing current conditions over the last 35 years and future conditions under climate change, future water use, and a combination of the two. So for the first time in Louisiana, we could produce estimates of flow everywhere instead of just at flow gauge locations, which had been diminishing throughout recent history. We have continued to update this model and build water management tools using its results since 2012. So what you're going to see here on the screen is from our Hydroflows app. It's the model viewer. In this app, users can view hydrographs and model results at the catchment and subwatershed scale. We provide the index of hydrologic alteration metrics because they're ecologically relevant. We also built a navigation feature into the modeling where a user can track flow by time and distance. This capability will help us understand the upstream and downstream ramifications of water management, flood control, or nature-based solutions projects. Because we have future conditions in a model, a user can also find out if a catchment of watershed will experience future surplus or future deficits of water throughout parts of the hydrograph. That's down here on the bottom right. We call that eco surplus or eco deficit. And finally, we built the capacity to link waterfall to modflow groundwater models so that we can actually develop water inventories and water budgets across catchments, watersheds, or regions. Seth, next slide, please. We also used the model to ask questions about water management and develop some tools to inform decision making. And I'm going to show you a couple of those now. Our first is called Oyster Flows. We built this because while upstream water management and water use actions can have profound effects on coastal habitat, coastal resilience is often discussed at the coast and not upstream. So we wanted to show that linkage of upstream flow conditions and coastal habitats. Oyster Flows allows you to manage upstream flows and see the consequences of those actions on downstream salinity and oyster reef habitat. It uses a combination of the waterfall modeling estimates, coastal salinity measurements, and the Chatry-Dugas curve that links salinity to oyster health in Louisiana's estuaries. We first developed this tool in 2014 for the Sabine and Calcasieu River basins. We developed Sabine in the top photo to highlight the consequences of water transfers out of the basin from the Toledo Bend Reservoir on the Sabine Lake Oyster Reef, which is the largest natural reef remaining in the Gulf of Mexico and perhaps the world. We developed the Calcasieu River Basin, which is the bottom photo, to highlight the impact of rapid expansion of water-hungry industry in this basin. And the fact that there is already salinity concern in that lake relating to oyster habitat in coastal marshes, and also there are substantial oyster restoration efforts in that, and many of those are led by Seth and his team. So in 2019, we received a grant from the National Academy of Sciences to update the Sabine and Calcasieu basins, and we also are expanding the tool to include Mississippi Sound, that's heavily impacted by the Pearl, Wolf, and Jordan rivers, as well as flood control diversion from the Mississippi River through the Bonnet Carey Spillway. We're also extending that work to include the Pascagoula River. Go ahead, Seth. The modeling has also allowed us to evaluate water quality. So this slide shows a tool we developed for and with NRCS to help them target their conservation programs with farmers to include water quality. So we actually linked the waterfall model with nutrient data to estimate loading rates on ag fields statewide. Then we applied Louisiana-specific conservation practices provided by NRCS, and we estimate the improvement in the values of sediment loading and nitrogen and phosphorus loading. So the top picture, I've zoomed into a catchment scale, and you can see in that top picture that all of the different types of crops are outlined in their acreage, and the different sources of current or as is loadings of nitrogen, phosphorus, and sediment. So what I've done in that top photo is I've isolated sugarcane, which is almost 700 acres of that catchment. And we asked a question: what if I applied a wetland to 10% of the area of that catchment, and to try to catch these pollutants before they get into the waterway? And so, what the tool then does is estimate and produce a return and estimate, and saying that if we did that, we could potentially reduce nitrogen by 40%. Phosphorus by over 40% and sediment by almost 40%. And we can also zoom in even closer to individual farm scale. So in the bottom photo, I've zoomed in to an actual farm field, and focused on sugarcane, as there's a lot of runoff from these farms. So it's about 420 acres of sugarcane, and we asked the question: what if we applied a 30 wide grass buffering strip across 10% of this farm acreage? And again, we see the loading rates of almost 40% for nitrogen, over 40% reduction in phosphorus, and over 50% reduction in sediment. So that we can do this across the state in agricultural fields. And we're currently training the NRCS field staff on how to use the tool with farmers in the field. Go ahead, Seth. And finally, the last thing is that we're working now with the Louisiana Watershed Initiative to try to expand this capability even further to develop tools to both help communities and regions select areas and design ways to incorporate natural solutions into their flood resilience plans, and also to help the Louisiana Watershed Institute score nature-based solutions projects in the context of more traditional gray infrastructure projects. So our goal now is to help Louisiana find ways to use nature where appropriate to help reduce flooding and improve habitats and communities. And I think that's it for us, Seth.
It is, Michelle, Brian, thanks. So that brings us to the end of the presentation. So I'm gonna leave this slide up, which has everyone's contact information on it. So if anyone wants to reach out to any of the presenters later, you're welcome to do that. Real quickly, just some of the take home messages, I think, for me from these presentations are, through the community rating system, it's a real marriage of conservation actions that actually lead to economic results for community beyond just the resilience, is there's actually, you know, savings in your own insurance rates. And that's, you know, there's a direct tie to actually, you know, again, taking care of open spaces and restoration. And with, you know, Strategic Rivers program, again, conservation is equivalent to flood protection, you know, which is a form of resilience. And so, you know, planning for those rivers and working to, you know, either recover some of the naturalness of their flow regimes or their floodplains actually protects communities in those watersheds. For the work that Chris talked about through the nature-based solution, again, there are demonstrable economic outcomes from that, as well as ways for communities to work together to think about recovery from disasters. And then again, working with the natural assets that you have in your community to really plan for that into the future. And then what we just heard about through a lot of the modeling is that, you know, we're able to now look at and predict into the future, you know, for climate and other things like that, and work again directly with communities on resilience. And so there's a real coexistence between, you know, natural spaces and conservation and resilience, and that there's a lot of value, at least in the work that we do, and I think most work in a lot of the engagement that we do directly with communities, and then the results, you know, with a lot of the mapping that it helps people really visualize what's going on, and then take, you know, actionable. They're actionable results that helps communities plan for the future and do it together. And all of this really relies heavily on having a lot of data. So we have 10 minutes left, I think, in this call. And I'm going to go into the Q&A and see what we have there and ask. So we have... okay. Excellent set of presentations, informative and data-rich. Thank you for the speakers and organizers. In general, from these presentations, we observe high risks of flooding, pollution, et cetera. We know what needs to be done in terms of policies and practices to mitigate these risks. Yet, actions are hard to do for many reasons. Can you all elaborate on the bottlenecks for these actions that can reduce these risks? That is a really good question, because that really is... the rubber meets the road in many ways. Would anyone like to take a first stab at Chris? You came off mute.
Sure. So I think the bottleneck depends upon the individual or the organization. So for a lot of local governments, the bottleneck is capacity to be able to plan for these types of projects. And I think across all different types of entities that might implement these, a bottleneck is just knowledge and awareness of what's possible and the benefits associated with these projects. So, you know, when they're thinking about hazard mitigation or how to reduce flood risk for your parcel or your building or your community, you know, 15 years ago, the default was all gray infrastructure. And we've worked very hard, as well as many other folks that work on nature-based solutions, to help increase awareness of the value of incorporating nature-based solutions, not necessarily on their own, but in concert with more traditional gray infrastructure, and exploring the use of nature-based solutions because it can be more cost-effective. And now there's a lot of funding available from conservation entities and from federal government to fund these efforts because they have multiple benefits. So I think across the board, it's an understanding of what's possible and what the benefits might be. But for a lot of local governments, I think it's a capacity issue. And we are seeing changes in some of the funding. For example, the new National Coastal Resilience Fund has removed a formal match requirement this year, which they still are looking for communities to bring match to the table, but they are acknowledging something that people like us have been saying for a long time, that some of these smaller under-resourced communities can't bring $1 million in match to a project. So they're not able to access them. So we are seeing changes help to address that bottleneck or that inequities in access. But I think conversations like what we're having today to help folks to really stop and pause and think about well, if the people that do the contracts for me to plan for mitigating the risk at my, at my facility or my parcel, if they're not bringing nature-based solutions into the conversation, maybe I can ask for them and see what comes about from that.
Thanks, Chris. Anyone else want to talk about bottlenecks, or move on to
other? Yeah, questions? I can jump in there with some of the things we've seen in the Catawba Basin. Is working with the local conservation groups, you know, they often need to go out and find funding to buy the land or put an easement on the land that they want. So they go to multiple sources. And one of the things that we've done working with them is basically come up with a scoring sheet. So the Catawba management group that operates within this basin, they have a pool of money and they can give out money to conservation groups to protect the lands. That's part of their mission, but they didn't have a common way to evaluate these types of projects and kind of compare one to another. So with the modeling that we've done, we've brought into it a quantitative scoring sheet that gives them a way to say this type of improvement is going to see from this project versus that project and that type of improvement. And that's what we're also working towards with the Louisiana Watershed Initiative work that we're attempting to develop, is to give them kind of a common baseline to evaluate projects so that there is a way for those that have to make the decisions on where the funding goes, they can be comparing one to another or quantitatively understanding the benefit that will come from that project.
All right, thanks. Thanks, Michelle. I don't see any in the open questions. There's a series of answered questions, which I think have been answered, but there's one I can't, maybe it was answered through text, but the question was, how are vulnerable or underserved communities being identified? And is this based on the CDC or SBI or some other measure?
I just answered that one in writing. So for SUNS, we are using the CDC SBI, and that's one of the layers in our map app. But we're also allowing communities or neighborhoods to self-identify as feeling left out from the conversation. And some of it we're just aware of from existing relationships. But for new work, expanding SUNS to other regions of the Gulf of Mexico, that data layer in particular is very helpful, as well as us taking a look at where funding has been allocated previously from the types of funding sources that we're aware of for nature-based solutions. So trying to understand why certain communities or counties are not accessing the funding. Is it lack of interest or is it lack of capacity?
Thanks, Chris. I don't see any more questions. Is there anyone out there that would like to type in a question real quick? We've got about 4 minutes left. And again, you're always free to follow up with any of us. But if there are no other questions, I will ask the panel if you all have any parting shots or final words about your presentations, or just sort of, again, that overarching theme of sort of the marriage of the conservation work that we do in the Nature Conservancy and resilience to and from, you know, disasters.
I don't, Seth, but I just want to thank everybody for listening to all our presentations today. It's been a pleasure.
Yep, I echo that. I appreciate it on behalf of everyone that presented. I really appreciate everyone's kind attention and participation. And a special thanks to the team at Texas A&M for making this possible and managing the webinar. It's made it much easier than if I tried to do it, it would have been a disaster. So pun intended. All right. Well, with that, I think we can close out. Again, thanks everyone for your participation, and I hope to cross paths with many of you in person in the future. Take care.